Thank you very much. Well, it's very humbling to be back again after another 4 years. Who was here 4 years ago? Wow. Well, I'm just continuing on what I said then. I hope you remember. I just want to add, or start with a point that, just an idea that it occurred to me that at the end of this talk, I will ask you a question, and I invite you, if you wish to answer that question, to write it down on a piece of paper and write your name on that piece of paper, of course, and hand it into the question box. And then at the Q&A, I'll see who wrote the best answer, and I have a prize for you. So pay attention. My interest in cosmology started when I was in high school. When I was 16, I wrote a book, co-authored a book on cosmology. I was an atheist, of course, at the time, and I believed that the universe didn't need an origin in time, no beginning and no end. This was very satisfying to me, therefore I didn't need a creator, and I didn't need to obey his laws. I continued in that position on through into my university years, where I became somewhat of an enemy of God. In fact, because that co-author of mine became a Christian, a born-again Christian, in the very last year of high school. And I argued with many Christians in university, like the Evangelical Union and this sort of thing, particularly about things like the origin of the universe, of the earth, where did we come from? And I asked those hard questions that I never received any answers to. But about 40 years ago, this was in the third year of my university, undergraduate, the Lord saved me. He chose me. He smashed me down. No one preached that message to me, but God somehow did. The Holy Spirit lifted me out of the pit, and I called out to God one night, and I asked him to save me, and he did. I became a believer, but I was still a Big Bang believer. Well, actually, at the time, I was probably more of a steady state believer because of that eternal universe idea. And that lasted up to about 1.5 years as a born-again Christian. In fact, the subject never really came up until one day a more mature Christian than I said to me, have you ever read Genesis in light of your knowledge? So I looked at it, spent 1 week reading it and studying it and asking the Lord to show me. And I could say within that 1 week or almost instantly, I became a creationist because God showed me that it was a far better description of the universe, the origin of it, its history, the earth and all this than anything that I had learned up to that time. Nothing. And nothing I have read or studied since, no evidence I have ever observed in the last 40 years would lead me to contradict anything that's written in Genesis. Astrophysics nowadays masses large amounts of observational data. They run simulations on supercomputers, they test their models, but there's no way they can prove anything about the past. That's absolutely impossible. They cannot prove how the universe came into existence by observation. Now you might think that's a bit strange. I will explain. If you have any doubts about what I'm saying, I suggest you read Genesis 1 and the rest of the Word of God, of course. And it humbles me that I'm even here to talk about this, really, because we all believe in the Word, right? But for those with doubts and questions, let me tell you this. Science cannot prove what happened in the past. This is even particularly so for the origin of the universe. But I'd like to quickly run through a little bit of history, a 5-minute history lesson, which I only know because it's written in books. It comes from the written record. And we'll get to see what this subject is really all about. It's about philosophy, not about science. In 1929, Edwin Hubble, the astronomer, discovered that what they thought at the time or that they called were nebulae, he discovered that these fuzzy objects were really separate galaxies from our own. It answered a big question at the time, that was our galaxy the only galaxy in the universe? He also saw that in the light coming from those galaxies, in the spectra of the light, the spectral lines were shifted towards the red end of the spectrum. This he interpreted as like a Doppler effect, just like the radar gun that the police would use to detect you speeding down the highway. I know you don't do that, but the other people anyway. He interpreted that the galaxies were receding from us, and hence this idea that the universe was expanding, and he measured the relationship between the redshift of those galaxies, and hence we got this idea that we have this expanding universe, and that was caused a kind of a revolution, right, in cosmology at that time. But it was an interpretation of the shift of those spectral lines. That's all it really was. Earlier in 1917, Einstein developed his own cosmology from his general theory of relativity. His cosmology, though, was a static universe because he believed at the time the universe was static. He called it his biggest blunder at the point when he heard that Hubble had discovered that the universe was expanding. And Einstein had inserted into his field equations this cosmological constant to make the universe static. And that's the blunder that he claimed later. It's really some type of a fudge factor, you see, to keep the universe static. This same constant today has been reintroduced in the form of what we know as dark energy, and we'll talk about that also. In 1922 and 27, both Friedman, Alexander Friedman, and Georges Lemaître independently developed their own cosmologies from Einstein's field equations, and those are the same model they developed, and it was an expanding universe. Which, of course, when Hubble made his discoveries, this seemed to match what the observations were telling them. Lemaître himself looked at the origin of the universe as starting at some sort of like a cosmic egg, some very small primeval fireball that exploded and expanded, and talked about it as some sort of moment of creation, because he was a Catholic priest. In 1950, now Sir Fred Hoyle coined the term Big Bang, because Fred Hoyle was a believer in the steady state theory, which was in opposition to the Big Bang model. And he was asked on BBC radio, what do the other side believe? And he said, oh, some sort of a Big Bang or something like that. But of course, then the name stuck. So you can see that this is ideologically driven, or religiously driven, because his belief was, in fact, until he died, he continued to believe in the steady state theory. And this is the true nature of this so-called science. It's really has a very strong religious nature to it. A student of Friedman, George Gamow, in 1948, predicted that leftover radiation coming from the original Big Bang fireball. Gamow and his students, Alpha and Hermann, made very detailed calculations with the very early digital computers that were developed at that time after the Second World War, and they used some of the unclassified information that came from the nuclear bomb research. So they had things like cross sections and information and conditions that went on side in nuclear blast, and they were able to make calculations what they thought the early universe was like, and then this is where they got this idea that there should be this leftover relic radiation coming from the Big Bang fireball. He predicted that the temperature of that radiation should be 5 degrees, or 5 degrees above absolute zero. Later, he revised it up to about 50 degrees. Couldn't really make up his mind, or something like that, because ultimately he got it fairly wrong, quite quite way off, in fact, because in 1965, Penzias and Wilson, working at Bell Labs, serendipitously discovered this microwave, cosmic microwave background radiation coming from all directions in space, and they measured the temperature of that radiation to be only 3 degrees above absolute zero. They won the Nobel Prize for that in 1978, and this discovery was considered to be sounding the death knell for the steady state theory, because this sort of was a, you know, verifiable prediction of Gamow from 1948. That's how the history goes anyway. And then one other major aspect of Big Bang idea today is this idea coined by Alan Guth in 1979, this inflation. Inflation was used to explain why we are living in a flat or a Euclidean universe. Now, I don't mean flat Earth here. I'm talking about, you know, normal Euclidean space. Euclidean geometry applies. 180 degrees in a triangle and things like this. This was later invoked to solve various problems in the Big Bang model. Now, what inflation really was some type of super fast exponential expansion of that initial Big Bang universe by a factor of 10 to the 78 in volume, driven by some negative pressure vacuum energy density. You know what that is? Well, no one does. It lasted from 10 to the minus 36 seconds after the Big Bang to somewhere between 10 to the minus 33 and 10 to the minus 32 seconds after the Big Bang. You've got to be kidding, surely. Hey, that's from Wikipedia. Come on, that's the source of all information. I looked that up myself. Come on, you guys. You're going to be tested on this. So has the cosmic microwave background radiation and this expanding universe idea proven the Big Bang? No way. Not even close. You see, as I said before, this is really a religious war. Ideological war, if you like. From the post-war period, there developed a sort of rivalry between the eternal atheist universe believers and the Big Bang evangelicals, because the Big Bang had an origin in time. And so the atheist steady-state believers didn't like the Big Bang because that sort of somehow connected it to the Genesis account. And it was rejected based on this fact, that it somehow brought in biblical creation. And you can see it from these comments. This one is by Fred Hoyle, a steady stater, an atheist. He said, "The Big Bang is an irrational process that cannot be described in scientific terms nor challenged by an appeal to observations." To counter him, George Gamow, who was obviously very much on the Big Bang side of the camp, he said, "I am glad to say that it isn't necessary anymore to pour Hoyle on the troubled waters of cosmogony." And this he wrote after the discovery of the cosmic microwave background radiation. You see, so there was this war, and it was sort of a Europe-America's war across the North Atlantic. Not totally that way, but generally that way. You can see that sort of ideological nature to it, can't you? Pope Pius XII announced in 1952 that the Big Bang cosmology affirmed the notion of a transcendental creator and was in harmony with Christian dogma. Wow, if the Pope says it, it must be right. You just pack up and go home, you know. It's all done. This article here from Reuters, January 2011 now, reports that the Pope has said Big Bang was God was behind the Big Bang. The universe was no accident. Therefore, theistic evolution. That's what he's essentially saying. God used this, you know, in the general sense of the whole universe. Theistic evolution must be true. But I would say that biblically, from a six-day creationist point of view, that that's an oxymoron, just as much as Big Bang creation is an oxymoron. You know, they make no sense, do they? They can't possibly go together. in that sense, it's just ridiculous. Today, what's the situation today? Well, the Big Bang is a philosophy believed by faith. There's no creator. It has only a naturalistic cause. Why is that? Well, because ultimately man does not want to bow the knee to a creator God. If he acknowledges God, then he also has to acknowledge everything else that he has said. All of the moral code, he has to acknowledge that. If the Pope could just understand this. This also highlights this issue. George Smoot in 2006 won the Nobel Prize for observations of these ripples or small temperature variations in this cosmic microwave background radiation. And he described this as the handwriting of God. Now, he's not a believer, and what he was talking about was some type of a god of the laws of physics or some sort of a New Age god, something like that. These very small ripples, temperature variations shown in this map here, where the dark spots are lower temperature and the brighter spots are higher temperature, this is what has been analysed enormously in recent times and claimed as very strong support for the Big Bang. You can see, though, how religious these physicists can get. Can these claims be tested is the question. And that's what we want to look at here. So what they do is they assemble mock universes with large supercomputers, taxpayers spending fortunes on building, paying for these things. They make statistical arguments. They have these massive mathematical models that they simulate in these computers. And this is how they test them. It's the only way they can test it. But are they testing their models on the actual universe? No, they're not. They're testing it on their simulations, on their mock universes. So you see, this type of science is very weak because they are not testing it on the actual universe, only what they believe the universe to look like. So let me let you in on a little secret here. And the following, I have three quotations from three leading cosmologists, and these are published in the prestigious Journal of Science in 2007. One of them says this, it was quoted as saying this: researchers have measured the temperature variations in the CMB, the cosmic microwave background, so precisely that the biggest uncertainty now stems from the fact that we see the microwave sky for only one Hubble volume, an uncertainty called cosmic variance. We've done the measurement, Charles Bennett says, it's not going to get any better. What he is saying is this: the problem is that we can't see all of the universe, and so they model what it should look like, but they only have one universe to test their models on, right? So they can't assemble a group of universes and say, well, this is what a typical universe should look like, because they only have the one. So all the other ones that they might test their models on to see if their theory is right are only in their supercomputers. No one knows what a typical universe should look like. The magazine went on to say that barrier to knowledge, some argue, is cosmology's Achilles heel. Cosmology may look like a science, but it isn't a science, says James Gunn of Princeton University, co-founder of the Sloan Survey. That's the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, which I'll mention later. He says a basic tenet of science is that you can do repeatable experiments. You can't do that in cosmology. So that's a good question you can ask your friends. Is cosmology a science? You've got James Gunn telling you it isn't. It's not even a science. They continue. The goal of physics is to understand the basic dynamics of the universe, Michael Turner says. Cosmology is a little different. The goal is to reconstruct the history of the universe, cosmology is more akin to evolutionary biology or geology, he says, in which researchers must simply accept some facts as given. You see, it's not repeatable, testable science, the sort of stuff I do in my laboratory. This is what the biologists and the geologists tell us, the same sort of story. You cannot run experiments on the past. So, they say, we'll just have to be happy with these just-so stories that they tell us about what happened in the past. It's the same stuff, isn't it? You know, all that long history of biological evolution, all that geology of the Earth, you'll just have to be satisfied with that. They're telling us the same story. See, cosmology is really a philosophy. It's not testable, not like in a lab experiment. It's actually historical science, that where they try to reconstruct the past history of the universe. And it's no stronger than the unknown yet assumed geological history of a planet, or the putative sequences, those biological sequences of organisms that allegedly produced a microbiologist from a microbe. The presupposition of the denial of the biblical authority, particularly the creation account and the Genesis flood, this idea has led to long-age beliefs of the earth. And it has been spoken about here at this conference that it was geological evolution that led to biological evolution. Darwin was a geologist before he was a biologist. He took Lyell's Principles of Geology on the Beagle with him. And the same is true here. Similarly, cosmic evolution comes from naturalistic thinking that we don't need a creator. How can we explain the universe without a creator God? And finally, this thinking has led to this idea that the universe created itself. And that's from Stephen Hawking himself, who said the universe created itself. Cosmology is not so much about empirical science, but about a philosophy. It's a worldview. So what are you prepared to accept as a fact? No evidence stands on its own. It's all interpreted in light of the worldview of the researcher, the cosmologist in this case, right? He is not trying to disprove or falsify his model. It is accepted as a starting principle. And often he accumulates evidence that is essentially cycled back to establish what he's already started with. And I won't go into any details on this, but I've seen this in my own experience many times. Often evidence is chosen very narrowly within a confined range that will cycle back to substantiate the standard model. And this today is now referred to as precision cosmology. I'll give you some examples of that. I quote here from South African cosmologist George Ellis, who said, "People need to be aware that there is a range of models that could explain the observations. For instance, I can construct for you a spherically symmetrical universe with Earth at its centre, and you cannot disprove it based on observations. You can only exclude it on philosophical grounds." He's being honest, isn't he? "In my view," this is him, still not me, "in my view, there is absolutely nothing wrong with that. What I want to bring into the open is the fact that we are using philosophical criteria in choosing our models. A lot of cosmology tries to hide that." So cosmology is based on Big Bang cosmology is based on this founding principle called the cosmological principle. Historically, it's an extension of the Copernican principle, which stated that the Earth is not in any special place in the universe. Because prior to this, of course, man believed that all the planets revolved around the Earth and so on. This cosmological principle says the universe is the same everywhere. No matter where you are or what time you are in the universe, what epoch, you would observe the same picture or same distribution of galaxies in the universe, and there'd be the same laws of physics and so on. It states that the distribution of matter is homogeneous, meaning uniform. Just remember that word. And also, no matter what direction you look in, it's the same. It's isotropic. the same in all directions. Without this assumption, this principle, there is no Big Bang model. It is utterly dead, completely. This is an essential assumption for the standard Friedman-Lemaître model, or it will not work. It collapses. But can you trust in this cosmological principle? They have to. It's an absolute must. If it's false, the Big Bang collapses. As a result, the model is believed more by blind faith than by observation. And I'll show you some of this. But as I said, it's the starting assumption used in interpreting all observational evidence. This is the picture I showed you earlier on the top right there. It's those ripples or this temperature variations of the cosmic microwave background radiation. And without going into any great detail, the data in these temperature variations has been discovered, within this data has been discovered what's called the axis of evil. Because they discovered that there's an alignment with this map or this data and the plane of the orbit of our solar system, the plane of the planet's orbit in our solar system, and even the axis that the Earth cuts with the sun, the orbit of the Earth around the sun. This is totally inconsistent with any Big Bang model, because the Big Bang says that this should be the afterglow of the Big Bang. There should be no correlation with anything local, with the solar system or the galaxy or even nearby. But these are lined up. And even the spins of there's an excess majority spin of galaxies in the universe even aligned in the same direction also, which is really strange, hence the axis of evil. Nevertheless, the presuppositional underpinnings of the Big Bang is quite obvious, isn't it? Now this famous Friedman equation is the result of the cosmological assumption, this cosmological principle assumption. But is the assumption valid? Famous physicist Richard Feynman succinctly describes the problem as this. He said, "I suspect the assumption of uniformity of the universe reflects a prejudice born of a sequence of overthrows of geocentric ideas." Remember the idea originally that the Earth was at the centre of the universe and we get this overthrow of this idea. "It would be embarrassing to find, after stating that we live in an ordinary planet, in an ordinary star, in an ordinary galaxy, that our place in the universe is extraordinary. To avoid embarrassment, we cling to the hypothesis of uniformity." That's that idea, uniformity. The matter distribution is the same everywhere. We're not in any special place in the universe. Without that, of course, as I said, the Big Bang collapses. This is the challenge. And I'm quoting here Dr. Richard Liu from University of Alabama in Huntsville. He said, "Cosmology is not even astrophysics." So first we had cosmology is not even science, and now it's not even astrophysics. It's narrowing it down. He says all the principal assumptions in this field are unverified or unverifiable in the laboratory because the universe offers no control experiment. That is, with no independent checks, it is bound to be highly ambiguous and degenerate, meaning there are many possible theories that could describe the same observations. He goes on to say, "Astronomical observations can never by themselves be proved beyond reasonable doubt, can prove beyond reasonable doubt a physical theory. This is because we live in only one universe. The indispensable control experiment is not available. We only have one universe. We can't interact with it, you see. There's no way to interact and get a response from the universe to test the theory under question like an experimentalist might do in a laboratory experiment. At most, the cosmologist collects as much data as he can and uses statistical arguments to show that his conclusion is likely." Wow, this guy's really summed it up. Hence the promise of using the universe as a laboratory from which new incorruptible physical laws may be established without the support of laboratory experiments is preposterous. This seems to be a fair analysis to me. Because cosmologists today have invented all sorts of stuff that has just the right properties to make their theories work. But the stuff has never been observed in their lab. Things like the mysterious dark matter and dark energy. Lou says that they have become comfortable with inventing unknowns to explain unknowns. I don't know if you remember, but 4 years ago I told you I got a research grant to detect dark matter. I got $750,000 from the Australian government, from you taxpayers. Thank you very much, by the way. And I've spent the last 3 years trying to detect these things called WISPs, weakly interacting slim particles. Not WIMPs, but WISPs. And guess what? I can report to you today that we haven't detected any, but I've spent your money, thank you very much. For the last 40 years now, experimentalists have been looking for dark matter from various experiments, Earth-based, space-based experiments, and it's never been detected. These are Lou's five unknowns. The unknowns are in bold. He says, this is why he says they're not real astrophysicists. Number one, galaxy redshifts. The redshift in the light we receive from galaxies explained by the expansion of space. So despite everything you've read that I've even written, even in my books, we cannot experimentally verify that space has expanded or is expanding. It's an interpretation of what redshifts are. That's all it is. Number two, that cosmic microwave background radiation is explained as the afterglow of the Big Bang. Nobody has seen the Big Bang, directly I mean. It's an interpretation. Number three, the perceived motion of stars in the disks of spiral galaxies, including our own galaxy, where we are right now in space, is explained by dark matter. This very room is meant to be 85% full of dark matter. If you thought you only weighed 100 kilos, you actually weigh 185. No, that's wrong. You weigh seven times that. You weigh 800 kilos. It's just that we can't detect it, and your scales don't detect it either. Sorry about that. You're all in the same boat. Distant supernovae are dimmer than expected. These are the exploding stars used to measure the expanding, accelerating universe. Hence, it's explained by dark energy. And number five, that the universe is flat. Euclidean space, normal space that we experience, and isotropic means in every direction we look, we see essentially the same thing. They don't understand why this is. It's explained by inflation, that super rapid expansion stuff that I quoted you from Wikipedia. These are unknowns used to explain the unknowns. And just on the expansion of space one, just to give you an interesting highlight of Hubble himself, the discoverer of the expanding universe, he was not so convinced of what redshifts really represented. In 1935, he wrote, "The possibility that redshift may be due to some other cause connected with the long time or distance involved in the passage of light from the nebula," remember they called them nebula then, or galaxy, "to observer. And it should not be prematurely neglected." He wrote that in a paper. So, another unknown of what this really means. Today we are told we live in this universe that is filled with invisible, unobserved stuff, 74% dark energy and 22% dark matter. That's the known normal matter in that little slice down the bottom there, the 4% of atoms. But what is this stuff? We cannot detect it. yet it should be all around us, as I said. Seven times the matter of this building should be dark matter. We can only say that little 4% bit, the atoms, should be everywhere. Max Tegmark, a cosmologist, he wrote, 30 years ago, cosmology was largely viewed as somewhere out there between philosophy and metaphysics. He said you could speculate over a bunch of beers about what happened and then you could go home because there wasn't a whole lot else to do. But now they are closing in on a consistent picture of how the universe evolved from the earliest moments to the present time. He called it precision cosmology. It's quite ridiculous. I recall some years ago, Nobel laureate Stephen Chu, he was speaking to a group of high school students in Australia in 2005 at an Institute of Physics Congress. I think it was in Canberra at the time. And he said to the, it was around 2,000 high school students, and he said that now we understand nearly all there is to know about the universe except for a few small details. What is dark matter and dark energy? That's 96% of the stuff of the universe, only a few small details. He could have encouraged them a bit, but there's a bit more work to do. As I mentioned, I was funded to look for WISPs, but the axion was a very famous dark matter particle that has been searched for nearly 40 years. And the name of the axion, this candidate dark matter particle, came from a brand of laundry detergent from the United States. And it was suggested this name because it would have cleaned up some of the problems that existed in particle physics back then. That was back in the 1980s. Well, they haven't detected it, even though searches are ongoing. Today it's still of interest to astronomers and particle physicists because they need this stuff to exist. It's exotic type of stuff that makes up 85% of the matter of our galaxy. And there's dark energy. This is a new material. We don't really know much about it. This website says new evidence has confirmed that the expansion of the universe is accelerating under the influence of a gravitationally repulsive form of energy that makes up two-thirds of the cosmos. This is a type of form of energy that is anti-gravity. It wouldn't gravitate together like normal matter and energy do. It would push things apart. So that's why the universe is sort of accelerating, you see. It goes on to say, it is an irony of nature that the most abundant form of energy in the universe is also the most mysterious. This is not meant to be a comedy. It's a serious scientific discussion here. Since the breakthrough discovery that the cosmic expansion is accelerating, a consistent picture has emerged indicating that two-thirds of the cosmos is made up of dark energy, some sort of gravitationally repulsive material. But don't believe it. They can't say what it is. It's like the problem with the emperor's new clothes. You guys know the story about the emperor? Well, he has no clothes on, really, does he? Few people have the courage to say the emperor is naked. You can't be certain that the universe is even expanding, let alone accelerating. The reason this stuff is mysterious is because it comes from the need to support a theory that's wrong. But they have nothing else. They're lost without a creator, without a God. They're lost. They're clinging to straws. In 2011, this team of Putmeiler, Schmidt and Rees, Adam Rees, were given the Nobel Prize for the discovery that the universe is accelerating. The expansion of the universe is accelerating from the observation of these distant supernovae. But don't believe it. We can't even be sure the universe is expanding because what causes redshift? And the standard big bang models are clearly wrong. I have a friend in Canada, in fact, who maintains a website where he has a list of potential mechanisms for redshift. And I think the last time I looked at his website, it was over 40 possible different mechanisms. and yet they stick to absolutely only one, because that's the only one which is untestable in the laboratory that will support the Big Bang model. Remember Sloan? Do you remember Sloan? I mentioned Sloan before, that one of those cosmologists back earlier was a team member from Sloan, the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, which is a very large robotic telescope that has been surveying millions of galaxies in support of this dark matter, dark energy paradigm. And it's ongoing. It's supported by a private foundation that's supporting in America. And they're searching the skies. But it seems to me what they're doing is man is building himself a new Tower of Babel so that man can say that he does not need God. The universe made itself and we can prove it. That's what I say. Don't believe it. You see, in terms of expansion of space, now I'm not saying that the universe is not expanding or hasn't expanded. But the message I'm trying to get across to you is this, that all evidence for cosmological expansion comes from the cosmos itself. There's no independent method to determine if space is expanding. You cannot experimentally verify this in a local lab experiment. So the evidence must be accepted on faith to some extent, which makes the argument much weaker. This is the problem, you see. Cosmology, then, is not a science, not a science subject to the same experimental rigor that a laboratory, repeatable laboratory science is subject to. You understand what I mean? So how ludicrous this so-called science has become with the invention of these unknowns to explain unknowns. You see where I'm going? The scriptures warn us, in fact, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. But instead, like the Apostle Paul, who wrote that he was given the grace to preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, it is also laid upon us to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. Thank the Lord. Amen. And so in these matters I pray, if I may, that God of our Lord Jesus Christ, that Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation through that knowledge of him, that the eyes of your understanding may be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of his glorious inheritance is in the saints. You'll find this in the Word of God, right? I mean, it's far more important than the science presented here today. I haven't presented you very much. Yet the science must be properly interpreted. If interpreted properly, it glorifies God. That's the important thing. The science itself is not important. It's all to the glory of God. Without the Creator, man is lost. He cannot find the truth about the universe. This book, have you read this book? If you haven't, you need to read it. It's available in the book tables. It shows the superiority of using the history of the universe given in the Bible to describe the correct cosmology. It's the cosmology believed by Jesus Christ, and this should be the basis for our thinking about the cosmos. This is a DVD that I recorded some years ago with this idea that if we look into the cosmos and what we see when we look out there, it's possible that we're actually looking back into day four of Creation Week, where the creation that we see out there, the creation of stars and galaxies and so on, is actually part of that day four creation episode where God said, you know, the expanse shows the work of his hands, his handiwork. Of course, then we have to explain, well, how does the light get here that we could look back and see into day four, 6,000 years ago, and yet see this creation happening in the cosmos? And you might find a solution to that problem in Starlight Time and the New Physics. This is a second edition. I recommend you get that. Now, I'm not saying that this idea is the answer. I'm offering it as a suggestion, as a possibility, because what I'm hoping to get over here is that there is no way to determine absolute truth from the about the cosmos from science. Absolute truth can only come from the Word of God. And you can get this on DVD form, Starlight Time and the New Physics, where I explain how this works, how we can see distant starlight if the universe is only 6,000 years old, and based on some fairly complex field equations, five-dimensional field equations. You don't have to study all that. It's animated and this sort of stuff. And there's another one there in the middle of the action. Those two DVDs are recorded here, I think. That's right, yeah, that's right, four years ago. And this one talks about this issue to be with where we are in the universe. And evidence seems to suggest that our galaxy, at least, is somewhere near some sort of local centre of the universe, that all around us galaxies seem to be arrayed in some sort of at least quasi-spherical structure, superstructure of millions of galaxies sort of arrayed in concentric rings around us. I call it the Hartnett structure. I don't know where I got that idea from. Actually, I've just as a point here, I've enlisted ICR, the Institute of Creation Research, to use their computer cluster, to continue doing some research into this. With one student of mine from the University of Western Australia, he's now doing his PhD in the astronomy group at UWA, and we've got Jason Lyle and Jake Hebert at ICR, and the four of us are now formed a team to work on this project using the Epiphany computer at ICR. So we want to push this forward over the next year and do some stuff in this area of research on galaxy structures. This is not the structure of galaxies, but the distribution of galaxies around us. Work that we couldn't do in a secular university. So you can pray for that, actually. And if you buy five, you get one free. So don't forget that. It's a great deal. You can get those DVDs out there on the book tables. I just want to add that these are not available here, The Heavens Declare. I made this with a friend of mine in America. I have a set of these with me, and these are a prize for any of you who can get the question right. And so you have to write it down, you have to put your name on a piece of paper and hand it in, and you have to list the unknowns used to explain the unknowns. So all you have to do, write that down, hand it into the Q&A box, and the first person I pull out who has